Hey, this is Zach Galligan here, and I am doing a message for the 80s slasher librarian. You know, I have some questions actually about your name. Does that mean that you are a librarian for 80s slasher movies? Or does that mean that you were born in the 80s and you're a librarian and you kill people? So you're an 80s slasher librarian? Yeah, see, I'm not 100% sure. Anyway, I was just thinking about that because, you know, the nickname is a little confusing. This is Zach Galligan, Billy from Gremlins 1 and 2, and you are listening to the 80s Slasher Librarian. See, now you can use that part. And now you don't need the part where necessarily I'm questioning whether you're actually a killer or just a librarian or from the 80s. Or any or all of the above. Anyway, enjoy and good luck.
Before I started tonight, I just had a really important message for you guys. I just wanted to tell you how Gremlin, you get out of that. You get out of it right now.
Episode of Out of Print Slashers. I am Sean Campbell. I am joined by the 80s slasher librarian, Josh LaRue. How you doing tonight?
Pretty good. We should have said holiday greetings.
That's right.
This is our Christmas, Hanukkah, everything.
Winter solstice, whatever you celebrate.
This is going to be, we're going to be talking about an epic Christmas classic movie, Gremlins.
it's interesting. I never actually saw this movie until last year, and it's not that I didn't like it. It's that, you know, when you hear about people talking about a movie for so long, you get it in your head what you think the movie is about. So yeah. When you actually see the movie, it's not what you pictured. It's not bad. It's just not what you thought, you know? And I always hear people going, Die Hard's a Christmas movie. Die Hard's not a Christmas movie. I'm like, first of all, who the cares? Second of all, this should be the Christmas movie. You know, action horror movie that everyone talks about, because that's the whole point of it. He's trying to get his son a gift for Christmas, and chaos ensues. So why isn't this one up there?
I don't know. I mean, that's also the plot of Jingle All the Way, you know, chaos ensues. I got to take some ibuprofen, so that's what I'm doing right here.
I love Jingle All the Way. I didn't care for the director's cut. The director's cut just kind of, I don't know, the extra scenes didn't really do it. For me.
Have you seen Jingle All the Way 2?
Is that the one with Larry the Cable Guy?
Yeah.
I haven't seen it. I heard about it, though.
I can't watch it.
I kind of want to laugh, but...
I live in Arkansas, so everybody expects me to be like a Larry the Cable Guy fan.
Get her done.
I almost said something political, but they would all be wrong. I was going to wear a Santa hat. I know you were asking a second ago before we went on the air where it was at. Pulled it out of my Christmas box where all my Christmas stuff is. It had a dead, looked like a dead brown recluse on it. The thing was completely dead. It looked like it had been like eaten by another spider. I don't want to know what spider.
You don't want to find the bigger one.
I don't want to know which spider ate a brown recluse. But I'm not putting the hat on. It's no more, there was no spiders in it or anything, but it's just on principle.
Fingers like snakes and spiders in my hair.
Dude, I feel like there's stuff crawling on me. Ever since I saw that, I feel like stuff is crawling on me.
Gremlins. That's what it is. Gremlins.
Right, there you go. It's you're going to be Futterman all of a sudden, eh?
I don't even remember him in the movie. And then
Are you kidding?
I saw the movie one time, and I was just trying to focus on what the hell was going on.
Yeah, but you watched Demon Knight, right?
Yeah, Demon Knight was awesome, and Billy Zane was freaking awesome.
Okay. But you really don't know, you don't remember Futterman from Gremlins.
Well, I didn't just watch Demon Knight. I watched it, then I showed Sophia Demon Knight because I said it was so awesome. So I at least watched that one twice.
But how can you not recognize Dick Miller in a movie? He's like one of the best character actors ever, man.
I don't even think I know a movie with him in it.
Gremlins.
I don't think I've ever heard that name in my life.
Demon Knight. He was in Demon Knight. He was the old man. The drunk. He was Uncle Willie.
I still don't know him.
Man, I don't know why the hell I talk to you about movies. Show's over. Canceled. We're canceled. Hashtag.
Why is the episode 6 minutes long?
Hashtag.
You can't fire me. I don't get paid. I don't get paid for this. You can't fire me.
Hashtag out of print slashers is canceled. It's over. No, it's Dick Miller, man, he was a great actor. You've probably seen him in a lot more stuff than you realize.
Yeah.
But yeah, the novelization was written by George Gipe, who I found out the other day died of a bee sting. I was hoping I didn't know he was dead. I was actually been trying to find him to see if we could talk to him, because he's also written other novelizations like Back to the Future and stuff like that. And I found out why I can't track him down. Somebody let me know he passed away to a bee sting, which is sad, because this guy was a good writer. I really enjoyed what he did with Gremlins.
Oh, same here. I like that it wasn't a carbon copy of the movie. This actually accentuated points that the movie didn't, because some stuff is more visually appealing, like when the Gremlins are in the movie theater and they're throwing popcorn and stuff. But in the book, they don't really show that, but then they'll show you what's in the Mogwai's heads. Gizmo, Stripe, and honestly, this is it's not just a companion to the movie. This book can be equally enjoyed as the other side of what you can't show easily in a movie.
And I want to say it before we get too deep into it, I want to say thank you to some people that did voices for this book. Tyrone Kinnard is a patron. He did Mr. Wing in the beginning, and he did Mr. Hansen, the teacher. We had Christopher Byrne Swanson, who voiced Futterman, and Bonanza Jellybean, who voiced Gizmo. And we had Stripe, the Mogwai and Gremlin, voicing himself. And I thought Stripe did a really good job voicing himself in the book. What did you think?
Yeah. I dug the voice cast in this, and I'm liking how
the patrons did amazing. Gizmo, Bonanza did great as Gizmo.
Well, a lot of the people that voice characters in this are trickling into Friday the 13th Part 3 by Simon Hawke, which you're now doing on the channel. I'm listening to that too. So yeah, it's really good.
Yeah, that Friday the 13th 3 with as many people as we have in it makes me really want to do a full cast book. Like, it's almost a full cast as it is. You know, I'm only doing like three characters, I think, is what I'm voicing, which is strange. But I would love to just voice one character and then everybody else voice a character. So hopefully, maybe with Nightmare 5 or something, we can knock that out. But Christopher did good, Tyrone did good, Bonanza did good. I hope I'm not missing anybody here. I'm pretty sure that's the only voices we had for the book.
Yeah.
If not, I'm a horrible person, and I apologize. I can't wait to do Gremlins 2, because have you seen Gremlins 2?
Or is that I haven't. I want to rewatch Gremlin before Christmas, just because I've read the novelization now. Okay. And then I think I will go on to the second one.
A lot of people will know what I'm doing here. In Gremlins 2, one of the Gremlins gets shot up with this intelligence serum, and he's called Brainy, the Brainy Gremlin, and he's like the main Gremlin in that one. And he talks kind of like, let me see here, let me try to get it going. Actually, the way we would like to do things is we'd just like to be accepted by humanity. Like I'm looking forward to voicing him, because I think that's almost dead on with that voice. That's going to be fun. And in the Gremlins 2 novelization, Brainy Gremlin steals the book from the author for a couple chapters here and there, like for a paragraph or two. He's like, oh, I'm going to write this here and tell the story the way it really went. So that one's going to be fun. But yeah, we're talking about Gremlins 1 today. The book really, really goes further than the movie, because you find out about this being Mogterman, who created the Mogwai as like a...
That almost sounded like it went into Jason X Death Moon territory. for a split second, I was like, did Jason X Death Moon create the Mogwai?
Yeah, it sounded like... I can't even remember some of the weird names from Jason X Death Moon. God, there were some weird ones, though. I can't wait to talk about that one. I'm trying to get a hold of the author. Hopefully, even though I've kind of shit on the book a lot, he'll be willing to come on and face the music with us. But, you know, DK, who's going to be on the next episode to talk about Final Destination, Dead Man's Hand, he's spoken to Alex S. Johnson, the author of Death Moon, and actually found out that he was going to write a Final Destination book and was glad he didn't have to, because he had no idea what he was doing. And that was after he wrote Death Moon. So that sounds like that's kind of what happened with Death Moon. You know, maybe he just had to fill in pages. Maybe our theory was
Death
correct.
Moon seems like some gremlins got a hold of the typewriter.
I feel like if they had told him to do it in like 180 pages, he could have told a cohesive, coherent story. But I think them making him stretch it out to 400 pages, it just went all over the place. But that one's coming up soon. This book starts off the way the movie does, with the dad, Rand Peltzer, in Chinatown. He sees the Mogwai. Mr. Wing doesn't want to sell it, but his grandson knows the shop's going to close down. Chases him out, sells him the Mogwai. I was a little disappointed it didn't go into more of the rules than the movie did, because I've always wondered, you can't get them wet, okay? Sunlight kills them, okay? Which, something happens in the book with that. The sunlight actually kills one of the Mogwai in the book, which I thought was a cool addition. But you can't feed them after midnight. That's a very vague rule.
One of the cops in the book actually says that, and he was like, so you mean to tell me you can't feed them after midnight? What time zone?
See, that actually, that dialogue is actually from Gremlins Part 2, and it was in the Gremlins 1. So I think it was in the original script and got cut for the first movie, so they threw it into the second one. Even the poppy seed part. But what I always thought was, like, after midnight is every minute after 12 midnight. So does that mean you have to feed them between 12 and 12:01 or 12 and 12:00:59, you know, because anytime
when do you start being able to feed them?
Yeah, 6 o'clock. You know, I don't know. It's weird. Once we get Gizmo at home, it pretty much plays out like the movie does. We get a little inner monologue with Gizmo wishing he could communicate better, but he thinks about his time, you know, on Earth, and how different humans had messed up and gremlins had been unleashed and all that. And it did go into a little more detail as far as that goes, like even Mr. Wing explaining why a Mogwai is such a great responsibility. But the differences really start really showing once the whole scene with Billy and what's the little kid's name again? Steven? I can't remember. The one that's dressed up like a Christmas tree. You just listen to it.
I thought it was Paul or something, but that didn't sound like a kid's name.
In the movie, it was Corey Feldman. I'll put it that way. Once we get to that scene where he gets one of them wet and, you know, the Mogwai multiplies, that's when the differences really start coming. And that's when we get more of a backstory, because Gizmo starts talking about different events in history that the gremlins actually caused, like something with World War II. Something in China years before that. And it's like maybe Futterman's little stories, because Futterman has a scene with Billy before this, talking about how in World War II, gremlins were messing with the planes and stuff. And you always thought that was just drunken rambling from Mr. Futterman, but the novelization takes it a little step further, and maybe that's actually something that happened, because Gizmo kind of references World War II and the Pacific and stuff. Also, guys, Mogterman that created the Mogwai was an alien race. Mogwai are aliens. That is their canon backstory in the novelization. This was supposed to be the story for the movie, by the way. The book is a lot darker in tone.
Yeah, I wasn't expecting that. Like, I didn't even remember more than like one or two people dying in the movie, but in the book, more people die, and they die in fucking Freddy Krueger ways. Like,
yeah, the
it was
movie
really
was
dark.
The script was really toned down. They took out the alien stuff. They toned down the deaths. Like, we're gonna get into it a little bit. The teacher, the way he dies in the movie, just has like one needle in his butt when they find his dead body. Way worse in the book.
In the book, they go in, and the teacher looks like Hellraiser.
Looks like, yeah, Hellraiser, syringe head. It's one of the different Cenobites. You know, we never saw syringe head. Cenobite always sounded like something you'd get at McDonald's for breakfast to me.
I'll take a Cenobite.
Like I'll have a sausage biscuit, some hot cakes, and orange juice, and a small order of Cenobites. You know, it's like a little.
That actually reminds me of that. Reminds me of an After the Slash thing.
Okay. But yeah, once Gizmo multiplies, we get this interesting scene with Stripe. Once Billy's out of the house for a while, Stripe has this conversation with Gizmo, and you heard that right. It is a conversation, not. Noises like in the movie, but an actual conversation. Clip, I think, is appropriate for this one. You got to hear it for yourself.
Yeah, go ahead.
Bonanza Jellybean doing the voice of Gizmo. Here we go.
Roll it.
How strange it was that a gentle and adaptable creature such as himself should be subjected to prejudice only by his own species. It was at times such as this that he really hated Mogterman, his creator. His genetic miscalculations assured that minority Mogwai, of which Gizmo was one, would be instantly recognized and hated by the majority. Physically, they all looked approximately the same. The massive differences were internal, involving character, ambition, desire for peace. So indelibly were these differences etched in the personalities of every Mogwai that there was no hiding or disguising them. Stripe was barely an hour old when he knew Gizmo was one of them. "So," he said coldly, "we've encountered one of the Eternal Ones. You are that, aren't you?" Gizmo did not have to respond. Stripe knew the answer, even as he asked the question, and it infuriated him. "It's not fair that you should be allowed such a long life, and we such a short one," Stripe hissed in Mogwai words.
"It was an accident of my Termin's creative process."
"You also have more knowledge than we," Stripe charged. "More life and more knowledge. Why don't you share both with us?"
"It's not possible."
"And you're glad it's not possible." Gizmo shrugged. "What is the reproductive secret?" Stripe demanded. "You saw how we got here, so you must know."
"Why do you want to know?"
Gizmo asked. "We want there to be more of us. If we're doomed to short lives, at least we can spread our species, enjoy the company of our massed millions."
"It's not a good idea,"
Gizmo murmured. "We'll find out sooner or later," Stripe hissed.
"I won't tell you,"
Gizmo said firmly. Stripe balled his short, pointed fingers into something resembling fists. "I want to kill you, Gizmo," he said coldly, "but I can't. Something is holding me back."
"It's the one responsible emotion Mogterman was able to keep in us,"
Gizmo explained.
"We're incapable of killing each other."
"You have other information we need," Stripe continued. "There's something that can kill us in a large doses.
cause us pain in smaller ones. What is it?
You will find out soon enough.
Chatswaba, Stripe rasped, swearing in Mogwai. Why must you be so secretive?
It's my only weapon.
There is another thing we must know,
Stripe persisted.
We are capable of becoming larger and more powerful. What causes that?
I can't tell you.
You can't, or you won't.
I won't.
It's foolish of you to withhold that. Why not use it for yourself, at least?
Because then I would become one of the majority with a brief and violent knife.
We'll find out what it is,
Stripe promised.
It's a simple thing. Intuitively, I know that. It can elude us only so long.
Perhaps much longer than you think,
Gizmo countered.
Perhaps it will elude you for your entire lifetime.
Stripe ground his teeth angrily.
Tell us now, and we'll go easy on your friends.
No, when you change, you'll forget.
Very well,
Stripe said.
Be uncooperative if you want. But we're going to find out what we need to know to escape these puny bodies and create more of us. And when we do...
Gizmo managed to face the infuriated Stripe with a determined look.
I think you're going to spend the rest of your lives in this room under very careful supervision.
He said evenly.
My new master is a very responsible young man. He's absorbed the Chinese man's wisdom, and I seriously doubt he'll give you the opportunity to enjoy your wicked ways.
As he recited the speech, Gizmo did not truly believe his own words, but they sounded persuasive enough.
But there are others,
Stripe shot back.
They will be careless. Especially now that I've instructed my four partners to be judicious in their choice of pranks. Fortunately, your new master corrected the mess we made last night. Seeing that could have put the others on their guard, but now they will let us roam free.
Gizmo sighed. What Stripe said was probably true. His only hope was that time was on his side, that these new Mogwai would expire in captivity before they could do any damage. A few hours later, a smiling Stripe trundled into Billy's room and shook Gizmo awake.
Claw is dead,
he said simply.
Now there are only four of you,
Gizmo replied.
Why does that seem to make you happy?
It is the manner in which he died,
Stripe said.
Ever since we arrived here, I've felt an instinctive fear of the occasional flashes of bright light we've been exposed to. This afternoon, when the lady let us explore the house, Claw went onto the back porch and was locked out. Before he could get back in, the sunlight destroyed him. So now we know an important secret of staying alive, which explains why this room is so dark.
Gizmo sighed.
Yes, it's true.
My intuition tells me there are three mysteries I must solve, and one is solved already,
Stripe gloated.
Next, we must find out how we can reproduce. Third, we must learn how to become more powerful. Are you sure you don't want to tell me everything now and save both of us a lot of trouble?
I'm sure,
Gizmo replied.
All right,
Stripe said, his eyes narrowing.
When we find out on our own, it will make what we do even more enjoyable. And all you'll be able to do is stand by, helplessly.
With a sneer, he curled himself into a ball and closed his eyes. He was soon asleep. But Gizmo, his mind racked with memories and fears for the future, found no solace the rest of the afternoon.
It almost seemed kind of like a Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde clip of them actually talking to each other, because they're one's kind of a darker reflection of the other.
Well, see, that's what I wanted to bring up. I have a theory about the Mogwai. The book doesn't say this. Neither book says it. The movies don't say it. This is just a thought I had. Each Mogwai that comes out of Gizmo is different. Like a different... One's evil, one's funny, one's deranged, one's crazy, you know. What if each one is a broken, is like a piece of Gizmo's psyche? You know, like a different piece of his psyche, a broken piece of his psyche. And then when one of those gets wet, it's broken pieces of that particular psyche. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like, that's something I, because it just seems like that might be how it goes because of the way they're different. Seeing if this is a message from our patron, nope, can't do that.
It's like, nope, it's my mailman. Bring him on.
No, he's just... He's not
I was just delivering a package.
I wanted to get the voice of Futterman on tonight to talk with us, but that doesn't look like it's going to happen. But yeah, you know, I always thought maybe it was broken pieces of Gizmo's psyche when they branch off like that. Like, Stripe is like the evil, superior, authoritarian type part of his psyche. What do you think?
Yeah, I mean, it sounds about right, because the way Gizmo, but by the way, like, at a certain point, Gizmo's thinking, my name is not Gizmo, and at a certain point, he's like, fine, okay, call me Gizmo, I'm Gizmo now. And he's like, why can't I communicate? That's not my name.
And even though their dialogue is in English, they're really talking to each other in Mogwai, but they can understand it. But humans can't, you know, if they hear it. But like the movie, he takes one of these creatures to Mr. Hansen, the science teacher. Also, another thing different from the movie is the old grouchy lady, whose name is escaping me right now. Can you remember her name? The old lady that owns the bank or whatever, the bitch?
It's not Miss Deagle, is it?
Yeah, Mrs. Deagle.
Okay.
She is way worse in the book than the
movie. My God, I never thought it was going to end with her. Every single scene, I'm like, I get it. She's a a-hole.
Yeah, she is like the witch, the Wicked Witch of the West. And she plays a big role in the first half of this book. Almost, it's like she's not, does she doesn't just want to get Billy fired. She wants to kill his dog, boil his dog, hang it from the street. It is horrible, man.
Announces this in the bank, and then everyone's like, what's going on here? And she's like, he's verbally assaulting me. I was like, you went on a rant for like 5 pages about how you're going to dismember a dog.
And
suddenly no one fucking heard that?
It reminds me of somebody else. I'm not going to say any names, but somebody that is crazy as hell and a big asshole, but nobody wants to piss them off, so they just do whatever they want and kiss their ass. You know who I'm talking about. That's Mrs. Deagle. That is what she's like right there. Everybody in town's afraid to make her mad, so they go along with whatever she wants just to appease her. They believe whatever she says. But there are people in the bank that witness this stuff, and they take Billy's side. Too bad his bosses don't. They don't believe shit. And one of his bosses is trying to hook up with the girl and that Billy's in love with, like in the movie. And in the book, it's a lot creepier. It's almost like that song, It's Cold Outside. You know, it was like a classic, you know, back when it came out, but now it sounds kind of rapey. You know, that's how this is, you know. So when am I coming over to see your place? You know, never. Oh, you know you want me to. I just said no. But no means yes. That's what the guy seems like in the book.
Did the after... Okay, I know I haven't seen the movie in a while, but did the bank scene with that dude, the one that happens in the book, you know which one I'm talking about?
Yeah,
did
not
that
the little
I don't remember that happening in the movie at all.
About the little people?
That was... That was a dark turn.
Yeah, where he's just like, he's gone crazy.
That was like a Stephen King twist in the bank. I was not.
Yeah. that was really strange. But yeah, the teacher hat, Mr. Hansen has one of the creatures there. And, you know, I thought maybe in the book it would explain, it would show how they unplugged his bedside clock. Like they did it deliberately. It was an accident. In the book, it's a total accident that that it gets unplugged. There's nothing there. I was really
I could have sworn there was a line in there where Stripe wondered if the clock ran on the same power source as the TV and he unplugged it. Like he wasn't 100% sure, but I could have sworn Stripe did that on purpose.
Well, I remember doing an outro where I talked about I didn't think that would be an accident, you know, but maybe.
That's maybe. That's when I was listening to it this week. I could have sworn I heard that.
Well, I don't even think he knew what a clock was, though. I don't know.
Well, that's what I was talking about, where he was wondering if it ran on the same power source as, like, the thing beside it. So he was doing that process of elimination thing. I remember that stuck out in my mind for some reason, because they said the Mogwai are really intelligent, and they'll basically work stuff out in their head, even if they don't know what it's called.
But regardless, it happens like in the movie. He ends up feeding them, wakes up, they're in their pot, their pods, I guess, for lack of a better word, their pupil stage. And from there on, it's pretty much consistent with the movie, with a little more character development. But here's the thing. Whenever the one at the school breaks out, the scene with the teacher is, like, way more terrifying and dark than the movie. And his death is just nuts. And the way that Billy finds him is nuts. And we're going to talk about that in a second. But let's play a clip of Mr. Hansen meeting his demise.
Roll it.
Then, pausing once again at the rim of darkness, he smiled.
Hey, man.
He said.
Let's go. What are you, scared of something?
Pushing the cart to the tub, he looked inside. The animal was lying on its side, obviously still cleaning itself of debris from the pod before exploring further. It fixed him with a cold stare.
Hello, boy.
Hansen smiled.
How was your trip to the Poopa Land?
The animal regarded him with neither friendliness nor open hostility.
I figure you might be hungry after all you've been through.
Hansen continued.
So I got you a candy bar.
He held out the bar, but the animal didn't reach for it. As he waited for it to make up its mind, Hansen studied the creature closely. He estimated that it was about 2.5 feet tall, a bipod with incredibly long arms. The brown soft fur of the Mogwai had been replaced by dark rippled armor plating that looked rock hard. Its paws and feet were now three-toed claws, and along its back ran a ridge of armor, not unlike that of a prehistoric reptile. The only feature that remained in any way similar to the old Mogwai was its nose, which remained pug and cute in the midst of a face that was notable for its malevolence.
Come on, boy.
Hansen urged, moving the candy bar closer to its mouth.
There's nothing to be afraid of.
Well into the darkened area, Hansen continued his line of patter, perhaps as much for his own benefit as the animal's.
See the candy bar?
He crooned.
Doesn't it look good? Come on, you better eat something, fellow.
Putting his hand on the edge of the tub, Roy noticed a bit of movement at the base of the animal's nose. It had obviously gotten its first good sniff of the candy bar and was interested. Moving the bar forward, Roy released it, barely a split second before a giant paw reached out to grab the delicacy.
Good.
Roy laughed, partly in relief that he had escaped with his hand intact.
You'll like it.
Slurping noisily, the gremlin began devouring the bar in a bite and a half. Hansen wished he had bought several more to keep it busy while he tried to get a blood sample.
I think you trust me now. So, we'll cut a trade. Candy for blood, okay?
Reaching gingerly into the cart, he slowly brought out a hypodermic needle and took a couple of more steps closer to the animal. It continued to munch happily, and soon Roy was in a position to reach out and get his sample. Lifting the needle from where he had hidden it alongside his leg, he made a quick movement forward. Fast as Roy was, the gremlin was quicker. At first sight of the syringe, its eyes narrowed, and the pupils glowed a fierce purple.
My God,
Hansen thought.
It remembers.
He did not have time to think further. With a loud snarl, the gremlin hurled itself out of the tub in Roy's direction. One set of claws dug into the man's shoulders while the other reached clear around his torso to enter his chest like giant staples. As he fell screaming to the floor, Roy Hansen saw that he was a good 5 feet from the lighted area. Billy roared up to the school, amazed at how few students he had passed on the way, but relieved that he would not have to deal with the traffic bottleneck at the entrance circle. Pulling as close to the front entrance as possible, he got out of the car and turned to the door. It was locked. Inside, past the cross-hatching of wired glass, he could see that the main hallway was in almost total darkness. The Christmas exodus seemed to be more complete this year than ever. There was a solitary figure in the hallway, however, so Billy pounded on the door with one hand and rapped his key against the glass with the other. Reluctantly, the figure, who turned out to be veteran maintenance man Waldo Sodlaw, ambled up to the door and yelled the obvious thing. "Closed!" he said. "It's an emergency," Billy replied. "Please let me in, Mr. Sodlaw." Perhaps knowing the old gentleman's name helped. In any event, he grimaced one time, sighed, and finally opened the door. "Thanks," Billy said.
"What's the emergency?"
"I've got to see Mr. Hansen."
"He's gone."
"Are you sure? Did you see him leave?"
"No, but I made a pass through his class. He wasn't there. Left the lights on in his lab, so I turned them off."
"Well, I'd better check," Billy said, starting to move down the hall. Sodlaw followed.
"I told you," he said. "He's gone. Now let me close up and get my work done so I can go home."
"It'll only be a minute," Billy yelled over his shoulder. Breaking into a trot, he left Sodlaw far behind, but could hear his footsteps echoing through the deserted halls when he turned into Hansen's lab and stopped. The lights were off, shades drawn, and no one seemed to be about, but Billy felt a presence. For one thing, the room had a strange smell, completely unlike any of the dissecting smells he remembered from his days in biology lab. When he heard a sharp intake of air, he jumped, looked around, but could see no one. He stood listening. Behind him, far down the hallway, Mr. Sodlaw was carrying on semi-hysterical conversation with someone else outside the building, something about a book left behind. Billy tried to separate those voices from a new sound closer to him, much closer, which reminded him of young girls trying to suppress a giggle. But where was it coming from? Billy had taken a step toward the light switch when he saw something that sent a chill up his spine. A shoe, with the foot inside it. It turned at an odd, uncomfortable angle, as if, walking slowly toward it, he saw the rest of the body lying behind the lab table. The twisted form of Roy Hansen. "Mr. Hansen!" Billy cried out. A wave of panic threatened to make him run from the lab, but he resisted. If the man was only injured or even in critical condition, Billy could do much more good by staying than rushing out. Breathing a silent prayer that Hansen was still conscious, he forced himself to move toward him. One quick glance at the body told him that Hansen was indeed dead. The same glance indicated that the death was not of natural causes. With mounting horror, Billy gasped at the sight before him. 3 dozen hypodermic needles had been inserted into various parts of Mr. Hansen's torso, making the unfortunate man into a grisly pincushion. In addition, there was a major gash, as if he had been knifed or clawed. A high-pitched scream reverberated through the lab. It was not uttered by Billy. Hearing the first echoes of it, he whirled to look into the shrieking jaws of what seemed to be something out of the dinosaur age. High in the air at Billy's eye level, the dark green armor-plated thing had hurled itself toward the young man from its hiding spot on the top of the nearby cabinet. The combination scream giggle ended just as the gremlin struck Billy's chest, knocking him backward and sideways. Tripping over Hansen's body, Billy cringed away from the massive claws as they passed less than an inch from his face. In an instant, he regained his feet, but so had the green demon, which immediately hopped onto the lab table and started another bombing attack. Billy ducked, causing the gremlin to clatter noisily against the wooden cabinets near the floor. It quickly regained its feet, sprung forward, and with one huge claw gouged a section of corduroy and flesh from Billy's leg. Holy sh! The epithet died, aborning as a second lunge by the gremlin brought the two together in a clinch. One of the creature's claws bearing down heavily on Billy's eyes. Turning quickly away, he lashed out with his forearm, striking the gremlin across the side of its face. It seemed more surprised than hurt by the blow, but Billy was able to slide out of its hot, greasy embrace. Mr. Sadlow! He yelled. Simultaneously, he made a break for the door. Though smaller, the gremlin made up the distance between them quickly, hurling itself against the wall in a kind of shot that closed the door and brought it face to face with its adversary. Billy looked around. There was no way out. His wound, which he had been able to ignore during the heat of battle, now began to throb with pain as he faced the leering creature blocking his way out of the lab. Then, with frightening speed, the gremlin launched itself once again, a savage missile speeding directly towards Billy's chest.
You know, it's funny when, well, I'll just go ahead and get to that part now. Billy is going to the school to check on the creature and stuff a little bit after this. This is what really sets, when this happens, because the book is kind of slow in parts in the beginning, but once this scene happens, things really pick up. Billy goes to the school to see what Mr. Hansen wanted to talk to him about. He finds Mr. Hansen's dead body, just pincushioned with those syringes, which was just nuts. Brutal death for Mr. Hansen. I don't think he deserved that at all. But even the showdown with that gremlin and Billy, in the movie, it's just kind of like a slash and it jumps in the air vent. But he, like, stalks Billy in this classroom, and the attack is like, it's like, it's suspenseful. You know, I wasn't sure what was, I knew he wasn't going to kill Billy, but it was still crazy as hell. You really got, if you're a Gremlins fan and you have not read this book, you should definitely listen to the audiobook I did, or you can get a copy online for like $6-7. It's not an expensive one. He runs out of there, and the janitor had let him in. And I'm wondering, that janitor is going to think he ran in there and killed Mr. Hansen, you know? Because Billy ran in there. Go ahead.
I'll say what it kind of reminded me of. I just felt like the gremlins in the book were so much more vicious and calculating in the book compared to the movie. And I was thinking of, do you remember that movie Super Troopers?
Yes.
When the captain was like tossing them in the same lot with Farva. And he was like, you can't compare us to Farva. Our shenanigans are cheeky and fun. His are sad and cruel. And it was like evil shenanigans. So I was thinking of the gremlins in the books versus the movie. It's like, don't compare us to the book gremlins. Ours are cheeky and fun. Those are cruel and sad.
Yeah, they're even described in a way that makes them sound a lot scarier and bigger.
Scaly, reptilian.
More like lizards, yeah. Not so much
that's
like...
kind of how they look in your pictures. But like when you're in the book, you don't have the images of the Mogwai and the gremlins. You have to kind of make your own idea. And to me, they just look freakier than
and
that.
Even sinister, you know, like scary, not, because even these are kind of whimsical, you know what I mean? It's still, and they're slimier and stuff in the book, you know, it's almost like they're slick with slime.
To be honest, in Harry Potter and the Goblet of Fire, when Voldemort comes back, that's how I pictured him, really snake-like, the red slitted eyes, the scales. I know they toned it down for the movie, but the descriptions of the gremlins in this book were a lot closer to Voldemort in my head.
And that whole thing at the school is what churns him into action. He's like, oh shit, my mom, and oh shit is right. Because when the Gizmo knows what they're up to, what they're going to try to do, even whenever they were just regular Mogwai, they were causing shit around the house, and they hurt the dog more than they did in the movie.
Yeah.
The whole scene, the kidnapping the dog scene, was hard to read, because I'm a dog lover. But like, Gizmo is trying to protect the mom at all turns. Like, he tries to warn her, but she's outside. And then when the attack happens, like in the movie, it's not exactly a carbon copy of Mom versus the Gremlins, but the way she fights back is more vivid, and the deaths of the gremlin she kills is more brutal. She murders the shit out of these gremlins in that kitchen. But yeah, what I was going to say, one of the Mogwai didn't survive long enough to become a gremlin, because before they became gremlins, they were trying to find ways to get out of the house and escape. And the mom and Rand Peltzer and Billy were allowing them to run around the house during the day. But they would, like, lock the doors, lock the windows. One of them got out on the back porch, and they found its dead body. You know, after it already started decomposing, had flies and everything. So one of the Mogwai dies because of the sun. They really set that there, that the sun will kill these fuckers. But fast forward, she's killed some gremlins, and Stripe escapes. Billy shows up just in time to save his mom. They killed all but Stripe. Stripe escapes, and Billy's going after him. And we have the whole thing at the YMCA where Stripe, you know, he attacks Gizmo and Billy, hurts Gizmo here. Gizmo gets hurt quite a bit in the book, more than the movie. So Stripe, you know, gets in the pool, multiplies, and this is where all hell breaks loose in the book. Would you agree? Like, more so than in the movie?
Yeah, they kind of focused on the TV news announcements of all the chaos that's going on. So we got this, you know, we didn't really see much of the gremlins after this point. You heard what they did, and you knew where they were.
Yeah, from, like,
it wasn't visually appealing like it was in the movie, so it's almost like the other side of that.
Yeah, because what we get is a bunch of, like a radio DJ breaking in, or a newscaster on TV breaking in, explaining this and this happening, and then one of the characters that are about to meet a gremlin hear it as it cuts off and picks up with that, with that character. For instance, Mrs. Deagle, she answers her door. I actually used the audio clip from the movie of the caroling gremlins, and it actually goes into a lot more detail in the movie about them coming into the house and, you know, messing with her wheelchair. She has one of them electric wheelchairs that brings you down the stairs. And her death scene is a little more satisfying in the book, because she is such a bitch, man. She has no redeeming qualities at all. All the way up to her
cat. Because you would think in her house with her cats, she'd be all sweet. But even in the cats, like, she'll feed them, just be like, eat, fucker.
Yeah, she's mean to her cats. She thinks these are kids in costumes. She's cussing at them, screaming at them, hitting them with brooms. I thought it was funny that the actual kids that were caroling thought that Stripe was an actual kid, you know, at first.
Yeah.
And I was like, is he going to kill these kids? But he hurts one of them and, you know, chases them off. But yeah, she dies, but you don't actually get the whole scene of the cops seeing her wheelchair flying out the window. You get it in a report on the radio about how she was found dead. And no, it was a report on TV. And then when that TV report gets cut off, you're in the home of the Futtermans.
Well, for her, it was like, Reports say that to hit the ground as hard as she did, she had to be going 200 miles per hour or something like that. I'm like, holy.
Yeah, they.
It's not even possible. Shouldn't even be possible to go that fast on that thing.
I think even George Gipe, who wrote the book, was just wanted her to die horribly. He's like, that is a horrible character.
Because I was like, even if they rewired that, unless they're magic, there's no physical way they should be able to wire that thing to go that fast. There should have been a rating. I don't know.
Oh, that's nitpicking. She's dead. Ding dong, the bitch is dead. And we get it cuts back into this DJ reporter or news reporter, and then we're in the home of the Futtermans. And we already got a thing earlier where we got to see his snowplow, or his he had like driven this tractor thing, given Billy a ride in it in the beginning of the book. It was outside the bar at one
Did
point.
Did any of that happen in the movie? I don't remember that character.
Yeah, Futterman was in the movie. He looked. They don't show him dying in the movie, and he ends up being in part two. But anyways, in the book, they're getting this, and all of a sudden the TV cuts out. You know, and he does the whole thing like in the movie to go fix the antenna. And when he goes outside, the Gremlins are playing on it. And I want to play that scene as our final clip tonight. And we'll finish discussing the book. Futterman dies completely. Officially not left in limbo like in the movie where he comes back in part two. There's no... What's the word I'm looking for here? It's conclusive. His death is conclusive. So let's play that clip.
Roll it.
The look on her husband's face told Mrs. Futterman that he was about to embark on a holy crusade. Although a generally volatile man, he never got that steely-eyed, twitching, nerve-in-the-cheek expression, except when somewhat crazed. She had seen it when someone stole the radio from his car, and another time when his favorite football team lost the divisional championship on a bad call by the officials. When he emerged from the basement with his rifle, she knew she had read him correctly. Murray, she said, taking his arm. What is it?
Gremlins,
he replied.
On the roof.
What kind of gremlins?
No time to explain now. You just stay inside.
But if you go out in the street and fire off that rifle, you'll be reported for sure, she protested.
Let go of my arm, Jesse,
he ordered. She did so, and he continued on his heavy-footed mission. Outside, he was halfway to the street and had the first gremlin in his sights when he realized that Jesse was right. Firing off a rifle from his front lawn was pretty foolhardy, especially when there was a window in the back of the garage which would provide an even better vantage point. Moving quietly into the garage, he groped his way past the snowplow, which took up all but 6 inches on either side, and pushed the window open. He smiled, for the view of his rooftop was perfect. And from here, the sound of his rifle would be partially muffled. Lining up one of the gremlins, he squeezed off his first shot. The little green demon proved it was neither imaginary nor immortal by falling in a heap and sliding off the roof. Futterman laughed out loud. It felt good to fire the rifle again, to be locked in combat with the enemy. A low chattering sound interrupted his excitement and train of thought. Where was it coming from? The rooftop? Somewhere nearby? There was no time to think about it. If the two other troublemakers near his antenna were to be dealt with, he threw the rifle to his shoulder and fired again. Another gremlin dropped. In his excitement and eagerness to bag his third enemy soldier, Futterman hardly heard the snowplow's engine roar to life. The third gremlin started to slide off the roof.
Oh, no, you don't!
Futterman yelled, moving the rifle to follow him. In a split second, he had the little target in his sights. Now the snowplow seemed almost to lean forward, its wheels ready to burst from their position, like sprinters from starting blocks. The engine roar became deafening as...
Hot darn!
Futterman cried out.
I got you, you little son of a...
He never completed the phrase. With a mammoth lurch forward, the snowplow tore through the back wall of the garage, taking Futterman with it in a shower of timber and bricks. Now all of you are interested in what the weather's going to be for the next few days, but you won't be able to find out by calling for the weather. No one's sure why, but calls to the telephone company's weather number are going directly to Carl's Sub Shop on West Monticello Drive. But you can't get the weather by dialing Carl's Sub Shop, because calls for Carl are somehow going directly to the Gamblers Anonymous hotline. Few minutes ago, an official with the phone company informed us that the Kingston Falls relay station was broken into earlier this evening, and that everything is in a state of chaos. So stay off the phone unless it's an absolute emergency. Meanwhile, three more cases of people being trapped in payphone booths turned up in...
But that's really the end of, like, the major differences from the movie. Because from here on out, you know, you got, after Futterman's death, the whole thing with Billy getting them all in the movie theater. You know, and I got to say about the movie theater scene, it played out really more suspenseful than the movie.
Yeah.
It was very well written. Because it was suspenseful, even though you knew kind of what was going to happen. He wrote it to where you're still like, shit, they're going to get caught, you know, sneaking behind them, turning this boiler, and then they think they're going to get blown up with it too. But there was a scene earlier, like you said, when they went to the cops, they showed the cops Gizmo, and they brought up the eating thing that's actually from part two. Didn't want to forget that. But yeah, so the movie theater, they blow them up just like the movie. And we end up in, like, the Sears or Montgomery Ward or whatever. Basically the same as the movie, except you get a couple darker spots and suspenseful spots here. The scene with Gizmo shooting the arrows at Billy.
You mean Stripe?
Yeah, I didn't mean to say Gizmo. I keep saying Gizmo. Stripe shooting the arrows at Billy. That was brutal, man. And, like, the plates and stuff, like the razor blades, the saw blades.
Yeah.
It was quite different than the movie. It was a lot darker. Stripe was straight up trying to murder. You know, he was killing. He was trying to kill. And the scene where Gizmo comes to the rescue in the car and, you know, ramping up and getting the blind, that was pretty badass. And we get a pretty cool scene after it's over, you know, with Gizmo at the end. But between the movie theater and the store, when Rand, because Rand doesn't show up in the movie like this, you know, in the middle of the action, but his dad shows up from the time they blow up the movie theater when they're running over to Montgomery Ward or Sears or whatever it was, and, like, they're trying to explain to their dad what's going on, because the cops have put, like, a moratorium on the town. They're not letting anyone in this town, and their idea is to hose down the Gremlins. You know, their idea is to hose down the Gremlins with fire trucks. So you can understand when Billy finds that out why he's in a hurry to figure out a different way to do it. That would have been the end of the world, probably, if they had hosed
them
with water hoses, fire truck hoses. So I thought that was a cool addition to the story. And, you know, Rand shows up the dad, and Billy's like, I gotta go, and the dad just keeps wanting to ask questions. He's like, I really gotta go. They're gonna come water hose this guy if I don't kill him. So Rand gets included in this final battle in the Montgomery Ward, kind of, and I thought that was a cool addition too. And after it's all done, Gizmo, or Stripe's death scene, by the way, in the movie with him melting and stuff in the stop motion, it's cool, but in the book, it's so slow and painful for him. Like, it talks about all the little gremlins that were getting ready to pop off his back when he got, you know, as he was dying. And, like, it explains that each of those were feeling pain and stuff, too, you know. He got a brutal death.
A lot darker.
Yeah, and of course, the ending is the same. Mr. Wing shows up to get Gizmo. Gizmo says, bye, Billy. But I gotta say, all in all, the book was darker. And I thought the addition of the cops coming up and putting out their plan about water, you know, using the fire truck hoses, really made the stakes greater for the book than the movie. I really enjoyed this one. It was a slow burn as far as the audiobook version went, because I was releasing one chapter a week, through Patreon as early access, so it took a while to upload the book completely, but I enjoyed it. I love Gremlins the movie. I know you just kind of like it, but I think the book is way better than the movie on this one. And if I could just forget, like, put the movie out of my mind completely and read this book and never seen the movie, I would think this book didn't really have many flaws. I would have to give this book a 5 out of 5. It's darker than the movie. It adds to the lore, interestingly, not stupidly. It's very suspenseful. The stakes are higher. The deaths are darker. And, the stakes being higher just ups the suspense. There's some comedic spots in it. It's good pacing on the comedic relief and the more darker stuff. And the gremlins were actually scary in the book. So I'm giving it 5 out of 5. George Gipe did a good job with this one.
Yeah, I agree. You know, there's two things in this book. I'm not sure if they're in the movie or how they're portrayed. But two things I really liked are, I hate tropes that are overused. So when Billy was like, hey, I broke our date last night, I have a mogwai, he's at my house, she was like, okay, let's go see it. Because normally she'd be like, okay, you've never lied to me, you don't have a history of lying, if you say this is real, I'll check it out. It's not like the whole, yeah, sure, and then they walk away, and then they spend the whole movie hit trying to convince each other. It was like, no, she's like, let's go check it out. And then there was a later part where he was thinking about hiding from his parents that he fucked up and multiplied the mogwai, but he was like, no, there's no reason to lie. He goes in, he's like, I fucked up, I multiplied him, and it was like, okay, we'll deal with it, rather than trying to hide it the whole time. I'm just like, the book didn't do that, but I've seen that done so many times, and I love that the book didn't do that.
Another thing that I loved about it was how the mogwai, the ones that came out of Gizmo, were trying to, they knew, they had enough of like a connection to Gizmo to know that he was keeping something from them.
Yeah.
You know, and the way that I think it was in some of the, maybe part of the clip we played with him talking, but Gizmo trying to make out what these rules were and stuff and trying to figure out how they
multiply. You mean Stripe?
Yeah, Stripe. How they multiply, and that since, and it's like a Gizmo saying this, so he must want me to think this other thing. Or maybe he's wanting me to think that I should be thinking this up. Like, to have Stripe sitting there, you know, because he's so suspicious of Gizmo. He's like, is he telling me the truth to make me think he's lying? Or is he lying to make me think he's telling the truth? Is he trying to throw me off? It was just really cool.
When I heard that, I don't know why I was thinking of Ben Stiller's White Goodman from Dodgeball. Like, is that how stupid you want me to think? No one makes me bleed my own blood. I'm just picturing Stripe as Ben Stiller from that.
So, great book. We don't have to cast the characters because it was a movie. Great Christmas film.
Yes.
I intended to do the book around Christmas, but I had a lot of requests for it. Gremlins 2 isn't really a Christmassy one, but I'm going to be doing it sometime early 2021, hopefully. Really looking forward to doing that one. Doing Brainy. I don't know what else to say. Check out the audiobook. It's right. We're going to have a link. There's a link in the description. Thumbnail at the end. It's a great Christmas listen. If you would prefer to read hard copy, it's out of print, but I got mine for like $6. My used copy, so it's not a super super rare one, but it's fun.
Let us know what you think, and let us know what your take is on the bank vault scene.
Oh, let's talk about that real quick.
Okay.
Yeah, he goes, the guy, the asshole from the movie, the younger boss.
I remember what happens to him.
He goes delirious in the book, and they show up at the bank, you know, there's some, because they go around town, I didn't want to give away everything, they go around town clearing gremlins out, like he saves his girlfriend from the bar, because the gremlins are all drinking and smoking, which if they're drinking beer, they're getting wet, so why aren't they multiplying when they drink? I don't make these rules, but maybe it just has to be water. Anyways,
the pool had chlorine in it, that's not pure water.
Oh, they go to the bank, and the guy's in there. He's delirious and says, this is like the new Earth. The little people will be the new... He's going to make a bank for the little people. You wanted to talk about the scene. Give us your thoughts on the scene.
He kind of lost his damn mind. He saw his dad get slaughtered, and he was just like, This belongs to them now, and is there anything I can do for you? Like, he's completely calm. He's not hysterical, but he is just completely insane by this point. He's had a complete emotional... Because he's never been emotionally stable in the first place.
Yeah.
But then when this happens, he's just like, I'm just going to be in the bank vault, like a panic room.
Should we do a bonus clip here for the end? End it on the clip?
Yeah,
so
sure.
So we're going to end it on the clip. When we're done here, we'll play that clip, take you home. So, thank you for listening. Have a happy Hanukkah, Merry Christmas, whatever you're celebrating. Be excellent to each other. Pleasant dreams! And be sure not to get your friends wet or feed them after midnight. And we'll see you next time on Out of Print Slashers.
This is Sean Campbell saying, if this one doesn't scare you, you're already dead.
If this one doesn't scare you, you ate after midnight. Here's the clip.
Poor Mr. Corbin, Kate breathed, their eyes rising from the floor at the same time they saw Gerald Hopkins in the background, apparently locked in the securities room of the vault. Gripping the steel bars like a penitentiary inmate, he smiled out at them, speaking in a deferential but firm tone of voice. I'm so sorry, he said. You're both too big to use this bank. What? Billy responded, puzzled. The bank is for little people only, Gerald explained. He held his palm approximately waist high and then continued in the same strange voice. We're going to redecorate the entire bank. Lower the teller's windows, make the furniture smaller, everything so that the little people will feel more at home here. He gestured grandly, but in a sort of slow motion as if he were in a trance or dreaming. This is going to be the first bank just for little people, he said softly. Think of it. And I'm the president. Kate and Billy stole sidelong glances at each other. If you ask me, I think his buttons are in the wrong buttonholes, Kate whispered. Could be, Billy replied. The world has needed a facility for little people for a long time, Gerald intoned. And now, with me as their leader, they're going to get it. Little people? Billy said. Do you mean the Gremlins? I don't know what they're called. All I know is they talk very fast and so funny, Mr. Corbin didn't understand them. That's why they... He broke off, then frowning. Yes, Billy urged. Go on. Never mind, it's too unpleasant. All I can say is that Mr. Corbin didn't want to go along with the little people. Of course, he's quite old and set in his ways. That's why he didn't understand their needs, but I did. So they established me as first president of their bank. Just as I thought, Kate whispered. He's as soft as a nickel cantaloupe. Gerald Hopkins fixed Billy with a gaze that was somehow both intense and vacant. You can be my head teller, if you promise to be respectful to the little people, he said. Your name escapes me, but I remember your face. With that, he threw his head back and giggled in a way that was eerily close to that of the Gremlins. Yes, but I'll let you work for me. Minimum wage, naturally. I can't believe this, Kate said, shaking her head. I told you terrible things always happen at Christmas time. It's not the holiday's fault, Billy murmured. Now, if you'll pardon me, I have a lot of work to do, Gerald said in the more formal tone. People who will be investing in the new bank are coming soon, so I have to be ready. Would you like us to see if we can get the door open? Billy asked. No, it's perfectly all right. Good day. He smiled blandly, but with a certain finality, and returned to the inside of the vault. Taking a seat at the small desk inside, he began writing with an instrument that, if not imaginary, was invisible to Kate and Billy. When the Gremlins raided this place and attacked Mr. Corbin, I guess it was just too much for him, Billy said. His mind must have gone. At first I thought he was putting on an act for us, but now... Poor guy. Well, Kate shrugged, at least he's got his own bank now. That seems to have made him happy. As Gerald continued working at the desk, Kate and Billy quietly left the room. What next? Kate asked. I don't know. A moment later, they stood at the entrance of the bank, staring out at the deserted streets of Kingston Falls.